Hello everyone, I welcome you all once again to my series of lecture that is Understanding Pharmaceutical Science with Dr. A.J. Hariharan. So today we are going to discuss about the morphological characteristics of bacteria. So I have divided this lecture into three major segments. So one, we will discuss one of the morphological characteristics, that is the size of the bacteria and what is the benefit the bacteria is having because of its size. Second, we will discuss about the shape of the bacteria, different shapes of the bacteria. Then third, we will discuss about the various arrangements of the bacteria. So once again, I welcome you to this lecture. So first, we will understand what is a bacteria. So everybody knows that bacteria is basically an unicellular microorganism because it cannot be seen with a naked eye. So we need a microscope to view this single-celled organism. So most of the cells we can classify into two major groups. One is we call as a prokaryote, second is the eukaryotic cells. So the bacteria falls into the group of the typical prokaryotic cell structure. So if you see what is meant by a prokaryote, so prokaryote is a Latin term in which the word pro means primitive, karyon means a nutshell. That means this cell structure which does not have an exact internal cell wall containing membrane structures. That means if you see a bacteria, inside it doesn't have a nuclear membrane so that it can hold the genetic material inside that, like a nucleus that you can see in a eukaryotic organism. Similarly, there is no well-defined compartment we can see in a prokaryotes, that is in the bacteria. Whereas we can see this in eukaryotes, such as it carries a mitochondria, Golgi apparatus like that. So this does not have it. And one more important characteristic, if you see that, the cell wall of the bacteria is generally made up of a particular chemical called as peptidoglycan. So this is the major difference that between the cell wall of an eukaryotic cell like our humans and the cell wall of the bacteria is having. Because of this change in the characteristics, what happens is our antibiotics works very efficiently only to the bacterial cells. That means it kills the bacteria effectively without harming our cells. Because if you see, most of the antibiotics that what we administer, like penicillin, which is a cell wall inhibitor, so it inhibits the synthesis of this peptidoglycan. Since our cell wall doesn't have any peptidoglycan, so our cells are not damaged, so these antibiotics work like a silver bullet. So this is the basic understanding of the bacteria. So if you see the morphological characteristics of the bacteria, so the morphological characteristic of the bacteria we can divide into four major characteristics. Not only bacteria, so any organism morphological characteristics we can divide into these four, sometimes we get three. For as far as the bacteria is concerned, we can divide into four. So one is the size of the bacteria, second is the shape of the bacteria, third is the structure of the bacteria, thus this we will discuss elaborately in my another lecture, and fourth is the arrangement of the bacteria. So we will understand each morphological characteristics separately. So why we have to understand this morphological characteristics is that these certain characteristics, especially the shape and arrangement, is generally help in the recognizing a particular taxonomic group of the bacteria, because it is an unique characteristics of a particular bacteria. For example, if you see streptococci, these bacteria, these species will be in corpus, will be in spherical shape and shown in a chain-like structure arrangement. If you see the certain aqua spirillum, it will be a spiral shaped one. So each bacteria will have a particular shape and arrangement, which is a unique characteristics of the taxonomic group. So now we will understand each characteristics elaborately. So the first one is the size of the bacteria. So if you see the size of the bacterial size is generally having a size range around 0.5 to 1 micrometer in diameter. More or less it will be spherical to some irregular shapes. So this size of the bacteria will help him to grow at a very faster rate when compared to your higher living cells. So because of this high surface area volume ratio when compared to large organism. So to illustrate this, what is this high surface area volume ratio, how it is going to benefit this bacteria, so we can understand by this simple table. So I have shown you a table about the comparison of this surface volume ratio of various spherical shaped organism. So if you see a diameter, we can keep three examples. Let us take a sphere having a diameter of 1 micrometer similar to a bacteria, and another is about 1000 micrometer, which is more or less similar to an hand shaped, or it's equivalent to 1 million micrometer, more like a human shaped organism. So if you calculate its surface area, so simple mathematical formula, 4 pi r square. If you calculate the surface volume, that is 4 pi r cube by 3. So we will get some readings by keeping this sphere as an radius half of the diameter as a radius. We can calculate it. If you see the surface volume of 1 micrometer will have about 6 times higher, almost if we compare to a large organism like a sphere of a human, that is 1 million micrometer, it is almost 1 million times high. So because of this high surface volume ratio, what the benefit the bacteria is getting is its rate of growth is high because of its high metabolic activity. For example, the rate of growth we can determine by means of its cell division. If you see a human cell divides at a rate of around 24 hours, that means a living cell of a one human to become an another human or a human cell to reproduce, almost it takes around 10 months or 10 months to get a baby. Whereas if you see the cell division which is happening in a bacteria and E. coli, its doubling rate is only 30 minutes. Your single cell can divide within 30 minutes and another cell because it's of its high metabolic activity. And moreover, since it is an unicellular, the surface area and volume ratio is also very high. So it can take the nutrients from its surrounding immediately. So the metabolic activity can be at a very high rate when compared to higher large shaped animals, living cells. So because of this, the bacteria doesn't require any circulatory system. So all the things will be done by the little or even without a cytoplasmic movement at all. So that's the one of the major thing, that is the size of the bacteria, major characteristics. And the second major morphological characteristics of the bacteria is its shape. So if you see the shape of the bacteria, generally the shape of the bacteria is determined by the cell wall of the bacteria. So the cell wall of the bacteria is generally made up of a particular chemical. I have already told it is made up of peptidoglycan, which governs this shape because it is more or less rigid in shape, and this shape will be unique and it is almost constant in a particular species of bacteria. For example, if you take Streptococcus, it has a spherical shape. If you take E. coli, it will be having a bacillus shape, that is a rod shaped one. It is characteristic in nature and it is also helpful in the identification process also. So if you see the most common shape of the bacteria, generally two is the most common shape. Sometimes a third one also I have included in this. The first major common shape what we can see is the spherical shape, more or less a round shaped one, which is called as coccus in singular, but in plural we call as a cocci. So similarly, the bacteria can exist in second major shape, that is a straight rod shaped one, which is called as a bacillus in singular, we call as a bacilli also in plural. So apart from this, some of the bacteria will be in rod shaped with helically curved. It is called as spirillum and spirilla. So this I have shown in the figure. If you see spherical shaped, in this example you can see it is a circular in nature, example Staphylococcus, a rod shaped one. I have told E. coli is a rod shaped bacteria, similarly Lactobacillus is there, and a spiral shaped rod one, which is an example is a Aqua spirillum species. So there is one more term we call as a pleomorphic, because some cells can exist in pleomorphic. So what is meant by a pleomorphic is that the same bacteria can exist in different shapes depending upon its conditions. So one example, if you can say Mycoplasma pneumonia, so it can exist in rod shaped, sometime it exists in curved shaped, some in a spherical shape also, right? So the third major morphological characteristics is the arrangement of the bacteria. So how the bacteria are arranged while it grows, because this characteristics is very important, because it can be helpful in the identification process also. So for example, I have told that the Streptococcus will be a spherical chain shaped bacteria. Staphylococcus is a grape like growth, we can see a spherical bacteria. So this arrangement helps in the identification. So let us understand the arrangement of a cocci. So generally cocci means a spherical shape, it occurs singly, means monococci, more or less it doesn't occur singly. It can divide in the same plane and forms two cells, and it will be joined together. So this will go further division like this. It is generally called as a diplococci. So sometimes a single cell divides in the same plane into two cells like a diplococci, and further divides in the same plane and forms a chain, then we call as a streptococci. So if a cell, single coccus cell, divides into a two cell and it divides in another plane forming a four cell, we call as a tetras or a tetrade. So similarly, if it grows in undivided form of this diplococci, we call as a staphylococcus. It is like a grape. Sometimes if you see this tetras, this four cell can further divide into a cubical form, we call as a sarcina. So if you see the arrangement of cocci, it can be in five types. So I have already told. So if you see, one is the diplococci, so this you can see, and second it can form a chain, we call as a streptococci. Sometimes it occurs in four, we call as a tetrades or tetras. Sometimes it can form say a grape like structure, we call as a staphylococci. Sometimes it will be in cubical in structure, we call as a sarcina. Right? This arrangement of cocci, that is the diplococci which occurs in pairs, or a long chained cocci like streptococcus, another few examples are there, enterococcus and lactococcus, also a chain shaped bacteria. Some will look like in dividing different planes and form a grape clump like structure of a spherical bacteria called staphylococcus, because the division happening in different planes, two or three planes, right? If it forms only four, then we call the septate grades. So if it forms a cubical structure, we call the sarcina, right? So the arrangement, how it is occurring in cocci, more or less it occurs similar in the bacilli also, but sometimes this pattern looks like little bit cocci-less than the cocci. So some bacilli occur singly, we call as a monobacilli, some occurs in pairs, diplobacilli, some occurs in chains, we call as a streptobacilli, for example Bacillus subtilis will show these characteristics. Some occurs as a branches of a tree, like a trichomes, example a Sporosia species or bigger toe species can form these types of structure, right? So this is the major arrangement characteristic we have seen. So one more arrangement we call as a palisade arrangement. So this palisade arrangement is nothing but if a match sticks falls on your ground, it forms at different angles. So this type of arrangement we call as a palisade arrangement. Example is the Cornibacterium diphtheria. So you can see in the picture how these palisade arrangements look like. So these are the three major characteristics, morphological characteristics. One is the size, shape and arrangement. So as told you, apart from these major shapes, certain bacteria occur in other shapes also and different types of arrangements also. Example, the Streptococcus species will similar to fungi, it looks like it carries an hyphae like a mycelial growth of the fungi. So this is the one of the different shape you can see from the picture also. So the Streptomyces species, how it looks like in the form of a mycelium. Sometimes it can be form a curve shaped bacteria, vibrioid shape. Example is a comma shaped bacteria, vibrio cholera, generally it causes cholera and dysentery. So you can see the growth of the vibrio cholera in the gut. Apart from this, some bacteria will have a helical shape. So this helical shape can be a rigid, it is called as a spirilla. So I have told you aqua spirillum. So apart from that, it may be flexible like a string, that is the spirochetes. Example, a Trypanosoma palladium is a spirochete. Generally it causes syphilis, a sexually transmitted disease. So the first picture shows the spirilla structure and this one is the spirochete, you can see from the figure. So apart from this, some bacteria exist in pear shaped one, example posterior species. Certain exist in a lobe shaped, example sulfolobus. Some with rod with square ends like a rectangle, you can see in the picture. Example is the Bacillus anthracis, which generally causes a respiratory syndrome in cattle. So some looks like coins stacked like the thing is a disc shaped one, example Caryophanon species. Some with rod with helically sculptured surface, example Silmeria species. These are the various structures you can see, most type of structure, but the common one is still is the coppe and the bacilli. So this, I think this lecture will be most helpful for you for understanding the basic morphological characteristics of the bacteria, that is its size, shape and arrangement. So apart from this, you can see in my next lecture about the various structures of the bacteria, and each structure I have given in an in-depth analysis of the bacteria. So thank you very much. So I will think that you will continue to watch my various lectures. Thank you very much.